Hey, this is Jim McDonald. Welcome to episode 193 of the PowerCast. This episode features our conversation with Jen Widerstrom of The Biggest Loser. She replaced Jillian Michaels a while back on that show and, in fact, has been on television before. She was in the second coming of American Gladiators. However you might feel about that show, about Biggest Loser, whether you're a big fan or if you have questions about whether people are able to maintain what they gain in the course of that show, what you cannot question is Jen's commitment to her clients, the contestants on that show. She is all in. She's absolutely all in. And the same with her clients outside of the show. She's got a lot of reps in dealing with people who have a lot of weight to lose and need to get back into shape. And she's written a book called Diet Right for Your Personality Type. It's available on Amazon. It's really sort of a kickstart guide into that lifestyle change that you need to make if you're going to be healthy for your whole life. Anyway, we had a lot of fun talking to her. She's got a lot of energy and she's just funny. She's a great gal. Like and share this episode. And we'll see you next week with Lane Norton. Support for this episode of the PowerCast comes from Ape Man Apparel. Apparel for people who lift heavy weights at apemanstrong.com. Compex Muscle Stim products at compexusa.com. Use the code PowerCast and get 28% off all but the lowest price model. HowMuchYouBench.net, home of Mark Bell's Slingshot. Bench heavy with no pain with Mark Bell's Slingshot. And Bodybuilding.com. Bodybuilding.com is the world's largest fitness website and supplement store. Bodybuilding.com has free plans for every level. Visit Bodybuilding.com today to become your best self. Our friends at Bodybuilding.com have another great giveaway for you, our loyal listeners. Here's what you need to do to be eligible. You need to follow Mark Bell's PowerCast on Instagram. Follow bodybuilding.com on Instagram, which is just bodybuilding.com. Tag three friends on today's episode. Three friends on the post for today's episode. That's episode 193 with Jen Widerstrom. Don't tag other episodes and think that you're entering. You must tag this episode. Here's what you can win. Protein, aminos, pre-workout, accessories, all in a custom bodybuilding.com bag. So that's what all you have to do. Follow bodybuilding.com, follow Mark Bell's PowerCast, and tag three friends to be eligible to win.
Recorded live in West Sacramento, California, this is Mark Bell's PowerCast. This week's guest, Jen Widerstrom of The Biggest Loser. Standing just to the left of Jim McD, here's your host, Mark Bell.
We're rolling.
Whose body was it?
Beth Horn.
Damn.
I get why they used her body, but I was like, oh, ego down.
I think this is the first person that we've had on the show that has had their own action figure.
Besides Superman and Jesus.
Well,
had them on the show?
Michael Hearn was not on in person, but he had one, didn't he?
I don't know.
Oh, Mike had one, for sure.
Yeah.
Oh, come on, the original.
The Titan?
Titan,
the original Gladiator. He was like JV squad in the 80s,
right?
And then
moved up to varsity in the comeback.
Yeah, come the new set, then
I have an announcement.
He also did Battle Dome. Something. Yes,
I forgot about that one.
I have an announcement to make.
Okay.
So Jen was talking about, you know, how when you're with somebody, you got to take care of business, and you got to stay in shape, right?
Yeah.
So
yeah.
We got talking about, like, if someone's single, you know, like, she feels that if someone's single, they might be more open to diet, whereas somebody who's attached may not be, right, and stuff like that. So
I like how this is how we're starting.
She kind of mentioned that, you know, if she's in a relationship, she'd rather, you know, work on
Keep it tight, I think is what she said.
Yeah.
Something like that.
Yeah. Yeah. And read into that whatever way you want. But
Oh my God.
I just want to say that.
I'm on my Facebook right now.
Shout out to my wife, because my wife's a genius, because this morning I got some, because she knows I'm hanging out with a chick all day. So she's protecting her territory, so to speak. Anyway, what's your theory on this?
Okay, I don't even know how we started this conversation earlier.
I do, because we were talking to Fat Dan.
Oh, we were talking.
And you're like, is he single? Does that guy just eat whatever he wants?
I was trying to find ways to motivate him, because he talked about my vascularity and what I've done. And I'm like, this is what you can do. And then as he walked away, I go, Mark, is he single? Like, what's the story? He goes, no, he's in a relationship. So then I thought, oh, well, that's why. Because yeah. I find that people tend to be more willing to invest in themselves. And, you know, it's like peacocking. You want to show up somewhere. You want to look okay.
That's right.
You know, shoulders back, a little more vascularity in Dan's case, whatever it is, because you're trying to accrue the
opposite sex.
The opposite sex of whoever you're trying to get the interest of. Okay, it could be.
Hey.
Could be, whatever. So I'm like, oh, is that why maybe perhaps Dan is Fat Dan, which I didn't know that was his full name. So
he
now
was
I know.
Fat before.
Is it Mr. Fat Dan or just Fat Dan?
Just Fat Dan.
It's on his birth certificate.
The only Mr. Right. in the gym, I think, is Mr. Robot Pants.
Mr. Robot Pants.
So Mr. Dr. Robot Pants.
Yeah, Mr. Right. Dr. Robot Pants.
Because I just want to make sure he's earned that, so
he
we
did.
Should give
he
it to him.
He did. He worked hard.
And he has a beard now.
That beard looks like AstroTurf.
It looks amazing.
It looks like red AstroTurf.
Perfect.
Isn't it?
It's like when you drive by someone's lawn, you go, is that...
Yeah.
I don't know if that's real grass.
It looks so red.
But it looks so real. And then you want to get out, take your shoes off, and walk in it just to be sure.
Exactly. You want to walk on his beard.
So that's what I'm saying.
You want to take... Can I just take
my health.
Can I just take my shoes off and rub them on your face for a minute?
Well, and we both know that Robot is one of the cheapest, tightest people on the planet. So you know he's doing that himself. Mm-hmm. Like, most of us go and get somebody to
cheap,
do this for you.
Is he cheap, or does he just know how?
No, he's cheap.
I don't know him well enough to give a vote, so
yeah.
Jury's out on that one.
He's frugal.
Frugal. That okay, that's fine. What were we saying? Oh, Fat Dan. So I thought that if he was single, he would actually care more about the way he looks, whereas I think the inverse is true. You've got to, when you're in a relationship, you should, I always like kind of up my game.
Right.
I just want to have it together and know that like it's responsibility.
You don't want the guy looking around at all.
I mean, first of all, if a guy's looking around, like, peace, lose my number. Okay, girl, I don't fucking need you in my life. It's fine. But I do think it's a responsibility to take care of yourself, because honestly, I'll speak for myself. If I'm not moving myself in the gym, if I'm eating shit, and if I'm putting on weight, or I'm not feeling good, or I get my skin gets ashy, or you let your hair grow in places that you don't want it to grow.
Right.
I'm not walking into the room with eye contact and feeling confident. Like, my eyes are on the ground. I'm less, I don't have as much of an opinion.
Gotcha. That makes sense.
So your whole vibe changes, and like I don't know. I think the guy in my life is going to want me to date the girl he started dating.
Now, so you do have a guy in your life.
I do.
Oh, awesome.
Yeah, it's new, but it's really going great.
Yeah, how new is that?
You're
getting all smiley. This is awesome.
4 or 5 minutes new.
We'll be older by the time this episode goes up. So
yeah, by the end of the episode, we'll be at least 6 minutes old. So.
You'll be at least a month apart, probably, by the time this airs. Shout out to whatever his name is.
Yeah, that's actually first name. It's Mr. Whatever your name is.
Mr. What's his face?
Since we're talking about dating, I got a question. I heard this on something else this morning.
Okay.
So you're dating a guy, and you're out on a date. Who pays?
Okay, this is. Do you mean first date? Any date?
Okay,
sounds like she's got like a list of rules.
Okay,
we'll
go first date, and then we'll go 2 months in.
I'm a bit old fashioned. I really like the idea of. I'm gonna give two answers, but I like the idea of being asked out. I think that's great. Although I've asked men out before, but being asked out, being picked up, brought somewhere, setting it up, paying for the tab. I think there's something that about our culture and history that's really. I think it's a beautiful thing. I love when a guy grabs my door. I mean, that's just really showing thought, forethought and care, and I like that. At the same time, I've been on some dates where I thought, oh, this will be great. I'll give him my address. He'll pick me up. And the guy was like a gong show. You know, he got like drunk on the date, and he got mad because I'd beat him at we went to like a game, like restaurant bar, and I was like beating him in Jenga, and he was like kind of getting mad. He's like, does anybody see this? She's beating me. I was like, holy, this guy knows my address. you know? And I was like, bro, we'll just go halves. I'll just, but it's cool. And I was kind of doing the bud thing. I was hey, this is a cool time. Just so he knew. It was just like, and there was, I was just like, I'm going to Uber home.
I don't think men get the point though. That's not
so
enough.
In that case, it was like weird. Cause like what I thought would have been the right first date, I was kind of hoping he didn't have my address and that I couldn't see him again. You know what I mean? Right.
I would have called you 75 times that night thinking everything was cool.
Drunk texted all night.
I got no idea what's going on.
But
I was thinking that we should possibly get married because today was pretty cool and I never had anybody beat me in Jenga and like.
What's your ring size?
God, you're so pretty. Da 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 da.
But I feel like we have a special connection.
Yeah, right.
Yeah. That's me. I'm like that. I'm the worst.
But 2 months in, I think it's different. I love the idea of you know, I think getting so many meals, a sense of like showing care and love, and you know, I like making food versus just buying for food. But
right.
Yeah.
I think that if you invite somebody to your house, you're paying for dinner. Like, you know, you're making it, you're paying for it. If you invite somebody out, you're paying for it. If somebody invites you out, they're paying for it.
100%.
Yeah.
100%.
And unless you just say, hey, this is going on. It's like, oh, do you want to go? It's like, yeah, I think we should go. Then maybe you split it.
Yeah.
Or maybe you go back and forth. You know, I don't know.
Trust your instincts on those things, pal. Yeah. Yeah.
So I don't know if you're aware of this, but you are a celebrity trainer. You're in that category. I know it sounds weird, right?
It's cool.
It is cool.
But it does it mean like that she's a celebrity
and she's far away from you guys
and she trains people or that she
Hey now, she's going to move closer. If she can move that giant pad that's down there.
Oh my god, it's really heavy. I'm on a ledge.
Now you've just been exposed. You're standing on something.
I'm on an apple box. Okay. I'm listening.
Are you a celebrity who trains people or are you a trainer who trains celebrities
Both.
Or are you a celebrity trainer who trains celebrities?
Yes, yes, yes.
And not celebrities.
I actually used to not train celebrities. It takes a lot with their schedules and trying to really accommodate that. And with my own career, my own brand going, I can't invest in the way that they deserve given the amount of things I have going on. So now, like that being said, this hiatus, I finished writing my book back in the summer. And so for instance, I took on a client, his name's Matt Lauria. I don't know if you guys watch the show Kingdom.
Yep, I've seen it for you.
Okay, he's Ryan Wheeler on the show. Just so I became a fan of the show and then
bring him up.
Matt and I had a mutual friend and then he asked me to train him and he's a great guy, vegan, hard worker, but he's the main actor in the show, Ryan Wheeler. And he's just such a rock star, works so hard. But so I am technically a celebrity training a celebrity person, but he's just, I mean, he's a pleasure to work with and, totally. There you go. Look at my boy. Look at a rock star.
Oh, there we go.
Yeah, he's unreal. Best guy in the world.
Looks like he's in good shape.
Oh, yeah. I mean, but you should see, being
all
vegan.
Abs and shit.
And look at his weight training. You know, there's a complication of how can we get him super.
How do you get the protein in there
How do we
stuff.
Get the size on that we need and keep him lean? Because, again, this is a show about MMA fighting. So having him make sure he looks the part and has that thing going is really critical. And he's very, they're all very method actors there. They all do the training. They all do the MMA. They all do the wrestling. Mm. They all do the conditioning. So that's why I said yes to all three of what you said.
You know what's scary is,
but I train civilians too.
Some of these people, they would take on training for something, for a movie, some kind of physical activity, and then they're good at it.
Oh,
or music too. That's another one. Yeah. Like, who is it?
Somebody learned something right there on the spot.
Yeah, a couple of people recently have had to play
piano.
Well,
I know Ryan Gosling, I think is what you're thinking with La La Land.
I think there was somebody else too recently, same kind of thing. But like Ewan McGregor in Star Wars got so into the sword fighting that he was actually really, really good.
Oh, I believe
it. And he had to pull back on people because he was...
Mm. Oh, but that's Matt, for sure. Matt Lauria. I mean, him wrestling and moving and grappling and doing... I mean, he's gotten so good. I mean, they're all going into the first season
right now.
Now he's
kicking people's ass.
You know, it's kind of... It was funny. He trained with me like a few weeks ago and he kind of was like... it was kind of neat. I was kind of, you know, moving with my trainer, like his wrestling coach, and he's saying I was doing like really well. Mm-hmm. And like Matt weighs in about like 165, 170, and you look at what those weight classes look like and the guys he's working with, mm-hmm. and you're like, it feels good, you know, to be like, I'm actually kind of learning this skill. It's fun to be a student and get better at stuff, you know?
Right.
If you talk to like an old friend,
okay,
somebody who maybe hasn't seen you in a few years, if you talk about your career, do you feel like a douchebag? Like, because you would end up name dropping a lot, even though you're not really trying to impress anybody. You're just talking about your day, like training this guy.
Yeah.
Like, oh, I was wrestling with so-and-so, and then I was over here with Hugh Jackman, and I did this with, you know, these people over here. Like, somebody be like, oh my God, like she's trying to, you find yourself kind of feeling a little awkward. And so maybe you don't really even talk about yourself.
What's funny is I still can't, like, even I was in Chicago recently at a book signing for the book. Obviously it was a book signing for a book. Cause I wrote a book.
What's your book called?
You wrote a book?
Oh my God. So what was, I mean, I had people in the audience that I went to high school with, that I had done like a cheerleading squad with, and I thought, I was like, why are you guys here? I mean, it's just me. They're like, but we've watched it all. And so part of it, I feel stupid. I'm like, but it's just me. And so them coming and watching the journey is pretty cool. But in answer to that kind of extended question, I kind of use the Gunnar Peterson method, because Gunnar's a dear friend of mine, and he'll talk. He talks
like the original trainer, like, to the stars.
Yeah, right. He's like, I have a client and we worked on this and we worked on that. And yeah, there was a movie we got ready for. I mean, he might talk and dance around, but he's not dropping Bruce Willis or Stallone. He's not
even
dropping
names. Even though he
knows
all of them. Yeah.
Even though that's exactly what he's talking about. Like, he wasn't super vocal. That, you know, he got Kate Beckinsale ready for her Shape cover and like for the Underworld movie. But she's been in the
Underwear movie?
Underworld. What'd I say?
I thought you said Underwear movie.
You said it right. His ears like, heard something different.
Are you sure? I have problems with ours.
No. You were fine.
I got excited about Kate Beckinsale in the Underwear movie.
Oh, it is your fault.
This sounds awesome.
Good thing your wife gave you nookie this morning.
That's right. That's right. Yeah, good.
Who
thing
knows what
happens.
You thought. So, right. I mean, but he I think was brought on for that. And now she comes in, she trains hard, she still works with him. And you wouldn't know, you know, because he's not on blast about it. And that's how he doesn't come off like a douchebag. And I think that I do the same thing. I kind of take the lead, talk about people. I have really wonderful people in high places. And I don't necessarily drop the name, but I talk about the experience, and that's kind of how I get around it, because I do feel like a douchebag if I'm like, oh yes, so the other day I was you know, here and there and saw who this and that.
Yeah.
Have you had a mentor in any of this process, whether it be you being on Biggest Loser, you know, someone teaching about TV, or someone teaching you about training, or someone teaching you about how to be in the fitness community, period, or even a mom or dad or something like that, that's been a real mentor, not like a role model, but more like a mentor?
Yeah, you know, it's tough. I feel like everybody that I've come through, you included, Mark, you know, you go through, you kind of bounce questions off of, you watch, you learn, you listen. So I think there's been a progression through the last decade plus of people along the way. But Adam Bornstein and Gunnar Peterson are two men that have really been there for me. And in a way that were Gunnar when I met years ago, I think he just kind of taught me to have the courage to lean into me. He's a very unique person,
what
has
do you mean
his
by
own
that?
Vibe. It's really to look at the rest of the room and the rest of what your peers are doing and try to replicate. And we kind of talked about this in our little interview at the LA Expo, but just no one can do me better than me. Right. I lean into this. I know me better than anyone. I love who I am. And that's always the first step in the room. And that's why it's authentic. That's why it's real. That's why when I talk, people listen. I don't have to be perfect.
So if we're doing something together, there's no, it's not great for us to compete against each other. It's great for you to talk about what you love and what you do.
Yeah.
And it's great for me to talk about what I love and I do.
Well, even in the way we do it, even in the news segment, right, when we did it, you know, we weren't fighting over who knew more about the warm-ups. Right. I was like, this is great. Mark's talking, and we have different ways of communicating and teaching and coaching, and that's special. And by the way, it can't be about competition, because this is a huge space where there's millions of people that are thriving in this industry, because hope still exists. And so we need to keep contributing to that, to what anybody needs.
Maybe we still need to get more people moving.
Totally. Thank you. So there's that component of Gunnar, like I said, He I think because he believed in me.
He has a gym in LA.
Yeah.
I mean, he's been there forever. He's been a celebrity trainer forever.
Space. But him, you know, someone of that stature that I looked up to, that I was like, you know, in the time I was like, I can't believe like Guns is like talking to me, man. That's pretty cool. Or, you know, and there's a few of the big names up there that have kind of watched what I'm doing and given the support. So someone, the power of when someone believes in you, it's, you start to consider, whoa, maybe I am kind of valuable or worth something, or have something to say. And the other person's Adam Bornstein. And Adam, he's really well known, more behind the scenes. He's more of a writer, did tons of stuff for Livestrong. He's ghostwritten a lot of books. And he's the one that encouraged me. Like, I met him through Arnold and Sean Perrin years ago, but he was the one who encouraged me to start writing years and years ago. He's like, there's something there. You've got to share what you're doing. And I was like, this is bananas. No one cares. I don't have, you're the writer.
Yeah. Everybody's writing. It's, yeah.
And
like,
he's like,
what
no, really. And he got me to start writing. And then when I had the book deal, I wrote the book, and I had a researcher help me, but I wrote it all. And at the end I was like, I had Adam kind of go through it and just look and help me organize my thoughts a little. And the book wouldn't have been finished without him. And it was because he was like, Jen, seriously, anything you need, I'm there for you. You just got to speak up. And like to ask a peer for help, I found is actually harder for me than I thought it would be. And I asked him, and it's like I wouldn't have started writing if it wasn't for him, and I wouldn't have finished writing if it wasn't him. And it's almost like, you know, Gunnar gave me the courage to be who I am, and Adam gave me the courage to put it down on paper and to share it.
Well, yeah. I've been working on a book for a long time, and I had a conversation with you. You're like, you got to do it. You got to do it. You're all over me. And I was like, oh, shit, I got to do it. And so I got with Muriel Tagg over here, who's works on Power Magazine and a bunch of other stuff for us. And I just said, hey, you know, we gotta push through with this book. There's good content in here. People need to know about it.
But it's kind of just scary. It's are people gonna get what I'm saying? Are people gonna understand? Is it gonna make a difference? And for you to not have written a book yet or shared what you like. I mean, just sitting in here when we were getting ready for the podcast, like the little moments, little conversations, and little cueing, and the little 5 minute talks about my squat today. It's just there's so much there that I think it's selfish of you to not put it out there. You know what I mean?
Just to keep it all trapped in my fat head.
Exactly. And what good is that? Your head's just gonna get fatter.
But you know, that's what's happening.
What is that Prevontaine quote? It's to sacrifice. The sacrifice, the gift. We're going to look it up.
Yeah, we're going to look it up.
Because that's what it is.
Prefontaine is loaded with great quotes.
Well, but he's a man with a great life experience. Yeah. I mean,
and he died at like 24.
Young. Crazy. Young. Really young.
Crazy.
To give anything less than your best is a sacrifice. Is to sacrifice the gift.
Right.
The
one you're looking. There you go.
So it's like to give less than our
best.
Look
at that mustache. Yeah.
So to... short what we're able to do. I think our gift, Mark, is to work with people, is to coach, is to get people moving. And that's why, I mean, even coming this weekend is about more than just food. It's more than just movement. It's about community and showing people how accessible movement is and how what a difference a community will do to encourage and enrich that experience. Right. So, I mean, that's the thing. It's like if you not to share it, I would be angry at you.
Let's back up a bunch here and let's try to make some sense of, you know, how you've kind of gotten to this moment.
Sure, yeah.
Do you have an athletic background?
Yep.
And that's kind of where the journey of lifting and fitness kind of started, or did it start before that?
Yeah. So I got an opportunity to do sports my whole upbringing. I did club gymnastics for about 10 years. And then as I got into high school, added in some track, added in some diving. And then in college, I actually walked on the rowing team because I thought, I'm going to try a new sport. And I was garbage. It was such a hard sport. It is one of the mentally most difficult things I've ever endured. And no matter how good I was,
it just looks like a bad concept to get involved with in the first place.
It's just boring,
man.
Getting in a
boat and it's cold and you're getting all wet and everything, right?
It's very early mornings.
And it's just
mornings.
The same thing over and
Doesn't
over.
Doesn't it seem like a bad idea?
But I'm like a 30-second athlete. I swear, like, no one's better than me in the world in 10 seconds, 20 seconds.
That's where Mark is, too.
Right. But that's why, let's, like, do that's what we're I'm good at.
That's why this morning went so well with
that's
you.
Right. That's right.
But that's also why I...
She knew it wasn't that a big time commitment.
That was in that time frame.
But that's why I'm also... I realized, you know, I improved. I worked hard. It wasn't for me. I quit rowing, walked on the throwing team, track and field, and it was a hammer thrower. And that was my background, where my coach, Doug Reynolds, who's still, by the way, coaching at Alabama, it was a steady diet of squats, deads, you know, overhead, snatch. I mean, everything we did was tons of lifting. I wasn't allowed to run. He's like, we need your weight up.
A lot of times with a female thrower or even throwers in general, male or female, they're usually big.
Oh, yeah.
Were you undersized?
Way undersized. So, this is science. Where's Dr. Robot Pants? You know,
mass
it's length,
some mass, yeah.
Right? So radius times speed is distance. Okay, right. That's a mathematical formula. So at 5'6", my radius, my furthest stretch on that hammer throw, I still was up against a wall. Okay, speed, I was really fast. I was a four turner. But the amount of strength you have to put into that release point for hammer, I mean, I was still, by the end, a 200-foot thrower.
So speed and strength, that's the only place you can make up ground.
Really, that's it.
You don't have the size.
But the faster I would go, the more, I wish I could demonstrate hammer throw. You have to stay really low in a crouched position, and that's why your front of your release is a snatch, right?
Okay.
So, but you want to stay in down in your leg, so when you get to that last release point, you have the ability to snatch that hammer. And I was maybe 150 pounds. And I was trying to go, and the faster I'd go, I'd pull out of my legs, and I didn't weigh enough to counter the speed I had. So it was constantly
unravel.
Do we slow down and stay low so I can really snatch? Because I was snatching almost 200 pounds in college. Or do I speed up and just say, fuck it, and see how far this puppy flies? I mean, and both happened. That's where I learned all my mechanics, all my form. And I mean, that's where it all came from for me.
The release scares the crap out of me.
Because
it seems like it could go anywhere.
But
if it were me, I would not be releasing in the same spot every time.
Well, that's why you're not a hammer thrower.
Exactly,
honey.
Exactly.
But it took time. I mean, I'll never forget. I walked on, and Doug, I was like, okay, I'm walking on. I'm ready. I get to lift weights. These are things I love. I don't have to run. I get to throw shit. Ugh. And then he literally gave me like a 5-pound, like a little plate. And he goes, okay. And it was indoor football field. And he goes, okay, just do heel turns, 500 yards. And I was like, I don't get to, but do I get to throw anything? He's like, no, 500 yards and you're done. And I had to sit with the plate, and I have to get off my, you can't even see. You have to like, heel turn, step. Heel turn, step. 500, I mean, do you know how nauseous I got? All the way down, all the way up 5 times, and that was my practice for the first 2 weeks. He's like, technique. He's like, you have to earn it to throw. And it was...
That makes sense.
Oh, no, completely. But I was like, ready to kill him. I was like, this is the worst. I'd rather go back to rowing if I'm going to keep doing this stuff. But at least I got to lift weights.
Okay, so is that right around the time the lifting started, or did you start lifting a little bit before that?
No, I mean, I started lifting, I would say, between like around 8, 9. I mean, like when I say lifting, my dad put 5 and 10 pound weights in my hands, and
Was your dad into fitness?
Yeah, my parents always, you know, my dad, you know, went to Gold's Gym in the '70s, right. And you know, saw Arnold once, and
That's cool.
I mean, it was that whole thing, and so
living
they're from Chicago, both my
Chicago.
Folks. So it was more of like weights and movement were always encouraged.
Right.
And then in high school, you know, even like the head football coach, Mr. McEwen, like he let me come in the summers, even if the football team was there sometimes, I would get to lift in the side and do my thing. So I've always had.
What a distraction.
You know, it's so funny. Like,
I would have been like, Mr. McEwen, get her the fuck out of here. Like, I cannot concentrate on what I'm doing.
And he came to my book signing in Naperville, and I said it to the crowd.
Just
I'm like,
killing.
But he let me do it. And because he knew, he's like, but he was like, you know, don't screw around. Like,
right.
You come in here, you work.
Right.
And it, you know, it was great.
Killing all those other boys.
But I was supported from the beginning. Yeah.
And then what was the jump into kind of the fitness community or even television? How did some of that happen?
Okay. So it's a funny thing. I think it happens to a lot of athletes out of college, and maybe just a lot of people, even if you're not an athlete or in any kind of sport. But if you would ask me a week before graduation, you know, Jen, what are you up to? What, you know, what's your life like, right? It's like, well, I'm going to the University of Kansas. I'm a Division I hammer thrower. Mm-hmm. I've earned a scholarship. I'm working on my degree in sports administration. I had all these titles, accolades that fulfilled my identity and made me feel important.
She's a Jayhawk, just like my wifey.
Jayhawk, Jack. Yo, Andy. And then a week after, if you ask me the same question, it's like, well, I'm bartending. In my hometown,
mm-hmm.
That's it.
I used to do X.
I know, and that's what got hard for me. I felt like I had all this built up. I worked, and it just ended. And I didn't anticipate.
Were you at least a good bartender?
Yeah, well, yeah, yeah. Come on.
I get tipped out.
And so it was tough for me. And there was like a 3 or 4 year period where I was just bartending, and I kind of started fitness modeling. And through fitness modeling, that's how I started doing American Gladiators, because the ads that were, you know, in Optimum Nutrition were in.
What do you mean by fitness modeling? Fitness modeling, like, I can't imagine fitness modeling being a thing in Chicago.
So Optimum Nutrition and American Bodybuilding, their headquarters are in Aurora, which is 10 minutes from my hometown.
Okay.
So essentially, John Spingola was their head of marketing at the time, spotted me at the Export Fitness, and I was like on the Stairmaster working off last night's hangover.
Just saw you at the gym.
Yeah. And he goes, we're going to test shoot tomorrow. I really think you'd be great. And I was like, yeah, you're a creep. Great. Yeah, leave your card at the door, pal. Like, come on.
Don't give him your address.
Right. And then I went and I grabbed and I saw it. And I'm like, I'm just going to see if it's real. And I remember calling and he's like, listen, we'll pay $250 and take some photos. And I was like, this is awesome. You're going to pay me like a night's work at the bar to take like photos for a couple hours. I was like, these guys are idiots because I don't even model. This is awesome. Mm-hmm. But those I did that, and those photos went in magazines like Your Flex or Your Muscle and Fitness and Oxygen. And because of that, the casting directors for Gladiators found me. So now once this all comes about, now I'm thinking, screw you bartending. I'm doing this. And now.
What year are we talking about?
We're talking 2007 to 2008.
Okay.
Yeah. So now what we've got is I've traded in, you know, all these accolades of what I'm doing to be important to now what I look like to be important. So all of my intention around movement.
Is this a second resurrection of American Gladiator?
Yes, okay. Exactly.
Because the American Gladiator was like on way before that.
Way back in the 80s, 90s, like the Nitro days, right? With Dan Clark. And then now this was kind of brought back with the Gina Carano and Michael Hearn was in that version and we had all that.
Right.
So now I'm in this position where all I did is I moved to look a certain way. So before it was always food and performance, food and workout for performance, and now it was just food and workout to look a certain way. And now I'm never really creating my own identity or what my passion is. I'm just trying to check a box. And so I do Gladiators, and it was one of those things where I still never learned about fitness. I was crash dieting for any kind of time we were filming or any kind of photo shoots I had, and then kind of get to the end of the day and then smash a pizza and a box of Oreos and probably some cocktails and then hate myself the next day and then start the road down to crash diet again. You know, that was just the cycle. And I, you know, I don't think I
spend 5 or 6 days working really hard towards looking good, and then you spend one day smash just it. Killing everything.
Yeah. But I don't think I realized how much it deteriorated me, like mentally and emotionally. It's a hard to yo-yo like that. And I know I'm not built for that extreme. And now this is the first time I'm exposed to television. You know, you're in a room with a lot of fit people. You're starting to think, God, I'm the fattest one here. And
you
got to
wear like tight fitting stuff.
Oh, I had the smallest outfit. Yeah. Oh my God. And you're looking around and now, you know, you start to think insecurity. You start to play the comparison game. And never once did I give in a shit. I like being an athlete and getting to move well.
It's
I
really
remember
hard,
my coach in college was like, I was like, I want to throw in the buns, you know, like the buns that the sprinters run in. Like, he's like, no, Widerstrom, no buns for you. I'm like, come on. And he's like, break the school record, we'll give you the buns. Let me tell you, I broke that school record, and I broke it again. And that was cool because then I got to break my own record over. I mean, I broke my record like, I don't know, 6-8 times.
Awesome.
But it was like, Widerstrom breaks the record again. I'm like, well, I just PR'd. I threw an inch further.
Does that mean your shorts got shorter and shorter?
Yeah. Well, my ass got bigger and bigger. I'll give you guys a picture of me in college. You'll be like, your eyes. I mean, it was a 315 squatting ass for sure. Oh, hello.
You said that sometimes now with TV, it's easy for you to get a little too big, not in terms of fat, but just in terms of muscle, looking big on camera.
It just doesn't translate. I mean, a great example is Ronda Rousey. We were at a Reebok event together. I saw her, lovely, and I just thought Ronda would be like, I'd be like, hi, Ronda. You know,
big personality,
you know, like literally eye to eye. She wasn't broader than me. She wasn't, I mean, I think I was a little leaner than her, but I just kind of like, hey, hi guys.
Right.
She felt very normal and very regular. Mm-hmm. Not that she's a regular person or a regular athlete, but I just, on TV and everything just looks larger and everything. And when I'm lean, I look leaner. When I'm muscular, I'd be like bigger. Mm-hmm. And so there's, you know, I'm very grateful for my genetic coding and my Swedish German roots, but I grow easily. And so I, you know, if I have to, unfortunately, have to worry about getting too big when it comes to season, because when I film, I want to be as accessible as possible. And sometimes if I'm too muscular, people think that it's too much.
Not as relatable.
And I want them to, I want them to be able to connect to me. Yeah.
My brother and I began 8 Man Strong with a simple idea: to encourage strength in this world, to bring back to life the grit found only in generations of the past. And while our brand has evolved since its founding, its core values have remained unchanged. We are here to promote strength, will, determination, and fight in people, to celebrate the strong, and to inspire those that need it. This is what it means to put on the 8-Man brand. So wherever you find yourself today on your personal journey towards strength, we encourage you to always move forward despite any obstacles you may face. And we hope you will do it wearing 8-Man. 8manstrong.com, apparel for people who lift heavy weights.
Have you noticed that if you lift a certain way, that does it make your diet go a certain way, or do you always try to eat a certain way kind of no matter what? Like, so if you power lift, does it make you want to like eat more like you're doing the heavy lifts, or do you feel just the heavy lifts just put bulk on you,
well,
period?
Well, I think that the food changes for me based on if I care about my performance. So when I was doing powerlifting training, I made an earnest effort. More calories went in, more starches went in.
So if you cared a lot about a 300-pound squat, you would have to eat more.
Fuck
and
yes.
then that would make you bigger.
Absolutely.
Along with the style.
But if I'm just moving to move and feeling great, No, I keep it pretty steady. You know, if I have a goal in mind, I tighten up areas. I watch my alcohol. I watch my sugar. And I make sure I'm eating enough. I'm drinking enough water and sleeping enough, like the baseline foundations of nutrition and health. But if I'm happy with where I'm at, I don't really worry until there's performance in there. And then I start to make an adjustment.
Walk me through, you know, what happened, how you got on Biggest Loser. Like, first of all, you know, how did it start? How long you've been with them, stuff like that.
Okay, so let's get out of, we're out of the land of American Gladiators, and I thought, okay, I don't want to go back to Chicago. I don't feel like going back to bartending.
So at this point, you lived in Los Angeles?
Yeah, well, because they flew us out for the show, and I think,
okay,
what's next? I just, it was kind of like, I don't know where I'm going, but I can't stay here, you know? And so I thought, I'm going to go to, I'm going to stay in LA. I had a few, I made a few friends, a few stunt guys that worked on the show, a few, you know, people that were my hair and makeup team. I thought, I'm just going to come and give it a shot. And I stumbled upon a gym in the Valley, called Pulse Fitness Studio, and I didn't have any money, and I thought I can work out for free if I work there. And so essentially, I started working in this gym. I wanted to work the front desk, and Mark was like, "Oh my God!" The owner was like, "Oh no, no, no! You're gonna train. You can do it." So I started teaching group classes, and what started out to me is just a way to get a free membership. Like, I didn't have my certification right away. I wasn't sure. Right. I mean, I understand fitness and movement, but I didn't have like my NASM and everything going. Yeah. But quickly, my classes started to grow. I had people asking me for private training, and I thought, well, I'll just do it for free. Like, I don't need to, I'm not like a trainer, but I was writing programming and helping. I got to the point I was like, I'm actually going to just start doing this because I'm doing it so many hours for free. Mm-hmm. So now fast forward, I'd say about 3 years, I'm building my clientele. I'm starting at 5 a.m. to sometimes 9 p.m. I'm teaching classes, and now I'm on the radars of other brands. I'm doing work for Women's Health, Men's Health. I'm doing videos. I'm doing content for MSN.com. I'm now being seen as a fitness expert. And so, and of course, Biggest Loser starts to bring me in for different opportunities to interview. Because I think Jillian's left like 3 times at that point. Like, oh, she might have left the show like 2. I don't know how many times,
yeah.
But every time she left, times, yeah, they called me in. So I've actually been brought in 3 times by Loser. And the first 2 times, they obviously went a different direction. And it wasn't until this 3rd time, back a few years ago, where they actually gave me the position.
You feel like there's anything different that you could have done, or were you trying too hard or something like that?
I was trying too hard. You nailed it on the head. I remember like the second to last time, it was when they had Anna Kournikova on the show, and they, you know, they bring you to the ranch, and they bring you these kind of pseudo contestants, and you do like a mini film, and all the cameras are there, and the producers are there, and I'm sitting there with my, I think I was here, or something. It was here or
arms
here.
Crossed,
I was very
or
genie.
Hands on
it,
hips.
Okay?
Yeah.
And I was like, let's go. I don't even remember. I was like out of body, and I felt like I was doing what I thought they wanted me to do, so they would like me to be on the show, and it just wasn't real, and it wasn't fully me, which is why they were right not to choose me. Whereas the last time, I thought, yeah, so I know what I'm doing. I don't need to be on this show, and I'm okay. If you guys want my help and I'm the right fit, cool. It's like, I mean, it's one of those things where I treat it like dating a lot, and I'm sorry I've said this to you before, Mark, but if you're sitting down with someone and you like me, that's great. If I like you back, like, let's just kind of go forward. If you don't, like, don't do me any favors. Like, lose my number. I'm going to be just fine. Mm. And I think there was a difference of knowing what I knew, like, knowing what I knew about fitness, knowing what I knew about people, and knowing I was going to be successful no matter what. Being on the show or not wasn't the pinnacle, wasn't the definition of me. It was a great opportunity, and I'm humbled to be on that platform and be able to help people and touch that many millions of people. But I didn't need it.
Can we pause
to
for a second?
Me.
I need to delete your number. I don't
know. Why?
I'm just kidding. You told me to lose your number.
So, so it was really, at the point that you were stopped maybe thinking about what kind of a platform it could be for you personally, and maybe just being your authentic self saying, I'll be fine. I'll do whatever without this job, that you're authentic
totally.
Self was coming through.
Because 3 years prior, it was only about me. What would the show do for me, right? Mm-hmm. I need it to be more. I need it to feel more special. Here I am developing an identity outside myself to make myself feel important to you or somebody else.
Right.
So I needed the show to feel important or to feel authentic or worthy or the expert. And whereas when I finally got the show, I knew what an amazing opportunity to help people.
Yeah, it's
but
not.
But I don't need it to prove that I can.
It's not about what you get out of it. It's about what you can become.
Absolutely. What I can become, what I can contribute, what I can do to really truly help people. Because people out there, they deserve it. They deserve someone that cares.
Oh, and by doing that and by looking at it at that view, it automatically increases your value anyway. Mm-hmm. That's the weird part.
I know. And I didn't know it at the time.
Yeah.
You know?
But it's something that people who are trying to get into anywhere in the industry, not just television, but fitness, period. And actually anything, anywhere. Your authentic self can't be a dramatically different person than your regular self. Your outside self can't be.
Well, I don't know why people feel like they've got to alter who they are to be valuable, to contribute. That's the biggest secret.
Yeah.
The people that get it, and we all find you start to float to the top. Mm-hmm. All we want is real people. We want real responses. Like that's, because I don't want to be around any of the bullshit.
If somebody's been under a rock for quite a while and they don't really understand how Biggest Loser works, how would you explain it?
In short, we take some severely obese people. They come to the ranch, and we've got a period of time where they're given a team, and I get to work with them, train them in the gym, train with them in the kitchen, train with them mentally, emotionally, and week by week get them down to a lower weight, but also week to week someone goes home. So there's an elimination process, mm-hmm. which probably is the hardest and worst thing for me overall. I mean, just letting, not knowing if you did enough for someone before it's their time to leave the show, because there is a competition element, mm-hmm. just kills me every fucking time. Like, it's the worst. And then at the end, we have a finale where we see who's done the best over the time, and that's how you do it.
The people who are eliminated, do they keep going and just off camera, or are they just gone?
So because there's a live finale at the end, there is an at-home prize incentive. But all my people, they go home. They've got my cell phone number. They've got programming for me. I've got communities I call, work with different gyms in their area, whatever city that is. I mm-hmm. talk with them. I work with the trainer. I say, this is what we're looking for, and set them up at home. Because regardless of the show, their life and their health long-term is what the most important thing to right. me. So if I don't give them a community to like kind of roll with in their neighborhood or their city, I'm dooming them. You know, I think the greatest thing you could do as a trainer and as a professional is know you need help. I cannot be the only one in their lives, because that's a disservice to them. So the more people I can get on their team, mm-hmm. the more successful they're going to be.
What kind of emotional strategies work with them the best, you feel?
Ultimately, most of the time, they don't think they're worth the investment. There's, you know, when you're eating at that level, you have to realize there's such a level of shame and embarrassment that they've given up a long time ago. Mm-hmm. And what people don't realize, but why millions of people continue to watch the show, whether you're severely obese or not, is because this is the story of the human condition. Everything that they're going through and they're sharing on TV, we all lean in towards. We all feel and understand a part of, because we all experience it. Now, I may not manifest my stress in eating or in that kind of weight gain, but maybe I don't sleep at night. Mark, maybe he has road rage. Maybe you're a jerk to your kids. I don't know. You know what I mean? It will come up somewhere though. Mm. And if you don't address it, it's going to be life ending for you, whether you're the walking dead or you really die because of that weight, right? So what happens is we have to address the psychology behind what they're doing, their decisions, and start to really help them own their worth. Because in the beginning, I have to believe for the both of us. I have to let them know they're worth it. And I invest so much that they're actually not training for me or trying for them. So they're not training for themselves or trying for themselves, but they're doing it for me. Mm-hmm. Like, I can't let Jen down. And that's how I start to get them going. It's kind of the fish on the hook. But before you know it, they're showing up for themselves day after day. And that's what I need them to know.
The whole thing is so wild. Somebody, you know, eating themselves to being that big, it takes a long time. And there's so many different things that happen in their lives that kind of lead to that. Ultimately, what's weird to me when I watch it, and I've had issues with my own weight, and I have, you know, body issues just like everybody else, image issues, stuff, all kinds of shit like that. My family's heavy, all kinds of stuff. But it's weird when you're watching it and you're like, this person's crying because they ate too much. You know, because they have these things that are these hurdles each day that they can't figure out a way, you know, to how do I stop this? How do I try to change? And I think the reason that they feel that way is the same reason why we all avoid change, because change seems like it's so painful. But mm-hmm. what a lot of people, I think, don't understand is that the change that you're about to go through can be more positive. It may be stressful, but it can cause a more positive change. But I think they're thinking, shit, this change is gonna be too hard. I can't do it.
Well, and then the fear of, what does that reveal about me if I can't?
Yeah, it's gotta be terrible.
We also have to remember that a lot of the times people are coping with food, and through the day, there is a million good excuses for them to be stressed, whether it's work, finances, relationship, kids, someone sick in your family. I don't know. There's everything's validated. But sometimes what happens, especially with these people, is all I have left is food. Because food does create emotion. It does create comfort. It does elevate
you.
You
hear the fucking ice cream truck come and you love it, right?
Like
you love the noise.
It's something to look forward to.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
And it's used as a tool, I think, at a younger age or before the weight, it's really at that level. And before you know, it starts to slip through your fingers. And before you know, I mean, the amount of contestants that I've worked with and people off the show as well, it's not just Biggest Loser, they'll look back. And I always make people take before pictures and progress pictures. And they say, I didn't know it was so bad.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I just don't know. It's the way your hands callous and you're like, God, I look down and boop, I got calluses. I don't remember. I don't feel all this.
Yeah.
But yet it's there. You know, you don't necessarily feel every moment of it until you're there and you think, how did I get so disconnected and so checked out that I'm not here anymore? And but what also starts to happen is because you see it in people's families. And let's say I'm married. And my husband's like, well, I'm going to grab like some chicken salads for tonight. Like, I don't want chicken salad. Right. They get angry. They get rude. Okay, honey. I'm going to give you one scoop of ice cream though. No, that's not what I want. Like, it starts to get anger. It comes out in other ways. And the anger is not about the person. It's not about my spouse. It's about something else that I'm not addressing. Until we can get behind that, it starts to get really scary for those people.
How do you get them to get momentum? Like, you're basically saying there's all these factors that lead to them being where they are. And then they have to face the facts like, look, you're where you're at. That's what happened in the past.
Yeah.
We need to figure out ways of moving forward and having you lose weight and having you follow this diet regimen and have you exercising and so on.
So here's my analogy. It's almost like, okay, you're taking a really hot shower, right? And the door's shut and you kind of get out of the shower and you kind of wipe the glass. And even though you wipe it, it's a little clear, but it kind of refogs up because it's there.
Mm-hmm.
But if we just crack the door, right? If we change the environment just a little, that smoke starts to dissipate and you can start to see clearer. And what I'm working with is a lot of people that are in that cloudy, steam-filled room, can't really see straight, so therefore they're not making really great decisions because they really don't know what's from what. Mm. And so that crack in the door is me proving evidence of their success, whether it's in working out and nutrition, that's just getting them to feel better.
Right.
They're going to literally feel better. They're going to go from walking to jogging. They're going to go from step ups to box jumps. Like, that's the evidence of success that I need. And what it starts to do is it creates neural pathways of success. They're like, oh, I did it. Okay, and I did that.
I do feel that there's some people in this world, too, that have never gotten a pat on the back. And so they get a pat on the back for doing a box jump.
And they're like, oh, I matter. That matters. And that success is what's going to fuel them. I think what I do really well with people is I let them feel the transition, feel themselves changing. Like, and what's cool is when they start to get it, whether it's, Jen, I put spinach in my tuna salad today. I was like, wow, you did.
Right.
That's a huge step. It's not a small thing. Or the workout's better. Or what's fun is you start to compete and get them to move more. And they start to kind of, you know, like, go for it, guy or girl. In workouts, it's like, oh, I didn't ask them to do that. They did that on their own. And you know what? You can't fake that. And they feel that.
And now the person that was struggling so much is maybe even trying to compete with somebody else.
Yes. And like I said, and that's that crack of the door. The environment changes. And my job is to try and get that door to stay open so they're clear, thinking clear. Because a lot of times they're just in their own heads.
It's a great way of looking at it. It's really cool.
Thanks. And I'm yelling at you.
You have your mom and your dad and stuff like that. Your other family members, are they supportive of everything that you're doing? Are they excited? Like, are people kind of?
Yeah, it's been crazy.
You have aunt or uncle or somebody like that records every show that you're ever on.
Yeah,
and stuff
like that. My family's been really great. It was it's been great. Like, I know my sister watches every episode and. It's been just my friends, family, even though I did book signings in Chicago. I mean, my cousins came out. It's fun to feel that I'm making people proud. You know,
that's
I really
cool.
share the victory with them because I represent the lives of people that are the only reason I'm standing here today. Yeah. You know, so it's, I feel responsible to do well, but not pressure, but responsible. So it's great, you know. And my dad has like, he's a personal trainer now at 71, you know, carries like a binder and has like pictures of me or Googles. Like,
no way.
Like pulls people like, rant, he's like, hey, come.
The grocery store or whatever.
My,
yeah.
Look at my dog, like puts me on the Google, on the TV. He's like, look on the Google, Jen, you know, and looks up. Like, and I was like, which picture did he show you? Because this woman said, your dad, I was at a grocery store and she stopped me. She says, your dad stopped me. And I'm like, which picture? He goes, he just put your name in on Google. I saw them all. And he made me sit there and scroll through, you know, like that's pretty. That's great. That's funny. I'm like,
so proud.
Me. Yeah. But no, my folks have been really great. My siblings are great. I mean, it's been really good to feel like I'm making them proud.
That's awesome. We have some questions to get to. Or do you have a question, Jim?
Actually, I was going to talk about the book, but if I got questions, let's.
We should talk book too.
Yeah, well, give us the rundown on the book. What's the title, and what are you trying to accomplish for?
So as I've yelled at you guys the last 3 minutes about Biggest Loser and coaching people, that's really the biggest deficit that I've seen in our fitness community. I think I see a lot of, this is a billion-dollar business of thought leaders bringing a lot of people the wrong way. I think the reason it's a billion-dollar business is because there's still hope. People believe in their ability to change and are hopeful that they can do it. And it's our job as fitness professionals to align and give them something that really works because they deserve it. And I think, unfortunately, we give them the runaround of all these magic diets and 7 inches and seven days bullshit that they can't sustain, so they can fail, right. So they feel like they need us. And that's not what I want. My job as a trainer is for you to not need me, to give you a program that you can, I can coach you in, you can learn, and you can take forever. Like, if I'm training you for the rest of your life, I have failed you. I want to always be in people's corner. But what this book is doing, which is called Diet Right for Your Personality Type, it is essentially a life guide disguised as a diet book. You go through a personality assessment, because what good is programming for someone if you don't program for the person that I'm talking to? Mm-hmm. If you do not take an individual approach to when you're training somebody, just like a teacher in front of a classroom of students, we all learn differently. And I've got to coach to the person, not make you guys fit to what I want you to do. Because one size will not fit all. If I make the world do what I do, I'm not going to be very successful with, I would say, 90% of the people.
A little bit like coaching. You know, you're coaching different 100%. People. One person, you might have to get up in their face and say, you're not giving your best effort. Exactly. What's happening here?
Exactly.
Somebody else, you might need to pat them on the back and say, hey, I think you can do better. Those are way different things, right?
The mark of a great coach is you can coach anybody to greatness. It's not about one person going. I think great coaches are the ones that can coach anybody. And I think that's what my parents, I think, have gifted me, both coaches and teachers. I know people. I was joking earlier, but there might be better trainers than me out there, I'm sure, and people that make more money than me or whatever and have more followers than me. But no one knows people better than me, and no one helps people take those first steps of fitness better than me. And what the coach the book does is basically coaches you through your own self-awareness. It elevates where you're at. What are your behavior defaults? What are your tendencies? What are your triggers? And then gives you a customized program based on those answers.
You can identify what personality type you are and then apply that knowledge to.
Well, we're the greatest. Like, listen, each of us are the greatest ass in our own lives. I don't want you to manipulate who you are. I want you to lean into it and be successful on it, because that's not what's going to change. I think a lot of times you see people telling people to do a certain diet that they can't keep, that they can't maintain. And if this is something you can only do for 1 week or 3 weeks, it's not for you. This book is a 4-week program that's meant to be replicated over and over, that you can live sustainably. And there's stuff, no matter what your personality type, I can't talk. And there are 5 types: as an organized doer, a never ever, a rebel, a swinger, and an everyday hero.
A swinger.
Yeah. And there's 5 core personalities. But regardless, there's a lot of great information about my kind of stake in the ground, with really simple, accessible information that you can take with you and really find success. Whether you're trying to lose weight, whether you're trying to sustain really good health, it's there for you, and it's all spelled out, and it will work. And that's why I wrote it.
I want to point out that Jen's like this all the time, by the way.
Oh, I'm like so
fired
up.
It's not because
up.
There's a camera here. She just is always a ball of fire.
I'm fired up. Well, people deserve it. You know, I'm just sick of the wrong shit out there. And I was really nervous to write it, because I know how to coach people and sit in front of you boys and talk and connect and watch someone move and give the right cueing. And I thought, as I told you, I'm angry if you don't ride your book. I thought, how selfish of me to not try just because I'm scared. Right? I was scared to write this book. I thought, is it going to be the connection I want it to be, the level of detail it needs to be for people to be seen.
A book can cause a lot of problems sometimes, or just writing in general, because you might say, hey, I'd like you to have a salad once a day. Then you have to explain why, and then you're worried about like how that explanation comes, and then it starts this giant ball of...
Oh, my God.
You got like 900 pages going on.
I tried writing first. Brain, hand didn't work. Tried typing. Fingers can't keep up with brain. So then I started dictating. I written thousands, tens of thousands of words on my phone because really? I just hit it in the notes section and I just dictated and I spoke it.
That
like
works
I would,
pretty damn good. That
that's
dictation.
What I did. That's what I did because I didn't know how else to do it.
Yeah, Gary Vee actually recommends that. We're going to see him next week.
Oh, how funny.
Yeah.
Just tell me about Gary Vee.
Yeah, that's one of the things he says that anybody can write because you can talk. If you can talk, you can write. You know, get it down and then you can figure out the grammar and punctuation and stuff later.
Yeah.
Somebody else could do it for you.
It's the truth. I mean, and I had a copy editor, a copyright underwriter that helps with that. So, no, it's there because people deserve it. I urge you guys to go check it out because it's on Amazon, it's in Barnes & Noble, it's everywhere. It's doing really well. It's already number one in new releases for weight loss and motivational self-help.
That's great.
It's really self-recognition around who you are and implementing that in the kitchen and in the gym and in a way that is going to be like a party. It's going to be great because it's all about you.
Comment on the phenomenon that I see a lot with people going on a diet or whatever where they're so zealous at the beginning that they seem like they maybe burn themselves out.
Okay, because there's a difference between a to-do list and a habit change. Also in my book, there's a whole, it's 30 years of research. It's called the Trans-Theoretical Model for Change. And it's about a six-step process that creates with the behavior change habits. Mm-hmm. So for instance, it's been used primarily with people that they're trying to help quit smoking or pre-diabetics. They're about to kind of take that unhealthy turn. And it's interesting that, so if, as a smoker, let's say I'm smoking, if I try to quit cold turkey, I only have a 3-5% chance of being successful. So it's not shocking to me that if I'm, as a dieter, going to jump into something that's rigid and kind of cold turkey, right, let's do it, I only have a 3-5% chance of being successful. It's not about smoking or food. It's about habit change. And so a lot of what I'm talking about in the book is those steps of pre-contemplation, contemplation, preparation, action. Like, there is a progression here, and I want people to be honest with themselves of where they're at. Mm-hmm. Because people throw themselves in the deep end and try to do this, like you said, this zealous effort to make the change, and it's not going to sustain.
Right.
Now, listen, I'm going to go to Mexico in a month. I'm going to tighten it up for a week. I'm going to not drink booze, watch my sugar, get to the gym every day. That's, to me, I have a very specific goal in mind. That's not a diet. That's just me tightening up because I'm going to be in a bathing suit, okay? But for me, what this diet program in my book is a livable, sustainable life. That's what it should be. There's no restriction. There's no cheat meal. It's just, it tells you what to do and how to live. Mm-hmm. And that's the difference. Like I said, I don't mind the short carrot. Like, I got a wedding in a month, or I got a bathing suit in a week. That's fine. But that's not what I'm coaching here.
Something I would tell our audience who's listening right now, if you're the kind of person in your family that people come to and say, hey, I want to lose some weight, but how do I do it? And then you know that the person's not going to listen to you, a book is a good thing to recommend because then it's not you, it's another authority, and people might actually follow it.
It also can be discreet.
Right.
It could be a big thing like, hey, you know, you
when is this airing, actually?
Probably about a month.
Okay, never mind.
I can go earlier than that if you want.
No, I just know there's a discount at Barnes & Noble this weekend, but it won't matter.
Okay.
It won't matter.
Questions.
That would be really
Two questions. Thank you.
Yeah, I have a couple. Here we go. Check. I have a couple questions.
Thanks for checking the mic.
Does this guy work here?
Checked already. I guess Jim had been talking.
Are we putting a limit on the beard growth, or are we just kind of going?
I'm just letting it go.
I love it.
I would love for there to be a limit on the beard
growth. We'll have to talk to HR.
Yeah, I would love that. Steven_WB on Instagram was asking about if going on a keto diet would be good for a younger male. If it matters, if age matters, if you should go into ketosis.
Well, I don't know what younger means. If that's 20s, is that teen?
He said 18 to 21.
The reason why I've said this many times, but just to be more clear, the reason why I like a no-carb diet is because I tend to have trouble with carbohydrates. It's not that I have trouble metabolizing them or anything like that. It's that they cause me to eat more carbs, and they cause me to be in a calorie surplus. The easiest way for me to be able to restrict my calories is through a high-fat, low-carbohydrate diet, so that's why I choose it. For somebody who's younger, I think if this guy isn't real heavy. I think probably his best route is to concentrate on gaining muscle, and having a more balanced diet would probably be his best route, because, you know, a lot of times the people that are hitting me up weigh 160 pounds, 200 pounds, somewhere in that range. If you're not big, I think your best bet is to add muscle. To try, that's the best way, in my opinion, to change your metabolism, not just for a day or week or month, but to change your metabolism forever.
Mm-hmm. Want me to respond too?
Yeah, why not?
Listen, I mean, I think if there's a goal in mind, then fine. If you want to do a couple weeks on it, a couple months on it, but the hard thing when I see those kinds of diets, they're not sustainable and livable. I think Mark is one of the few people that has actually really taken it on and made it a lifestyle habit. But what I mostly see are people restricting and going for it and then rebounding. And now we're going to go from the super lean to really unhappy. And now we're constantly fighting to get back where you can't live because that's not sustainable. So I don't encourage any diet extremes just because I don't, unless
you just swing the other way too much. Yeah.
Yeah. So that's my concern. But I agree with him, especially at that age. I mean, there's nothing, it's no greater time for a male, especially, to build lean, solid muscle tissue that'll last for like decades past your 18th or 21.
Focus on getting jacked and don't worry about being tan.
Okay. That's actually, we could have saved 3 minutes. Yeah. Why didn't you say that an hour ago?
That could have been just it. At bees_wax on Instagram was asking about lifting over the age of 40. Do you think you have to lift a little bit lighter once you hit 40, or is it a fair game?
Oh, absolutely not. I mean, honestly, I almost treat that like a...
You said your dad's 70.
Yeah, my dad's 71. My mom is 68. My mom's lifting. She's deadlifting. Now, I almost treat it like when you get older, I almost treat it like a pregnant woman. If you were doing it before, continue doing it now. So if you're over 40 and just starting, yes, absolutely do it. I couldn't recommend it enough, but you want to layer the load. So don't start right away with big weights and try to compete with other people in the gym. I remember I was even talking with Dolph Lundgren, and he was talking about how he was trying to like move...
He dies.
That one. But he tries to move weight like he did when he was younger, and you know, and he really paid for it. So you got to remember, like, make sure the load is correct for where you are in your training. So if you're new, layer it up. And if you've done it before, still pay attention. But heck yeah, there's nothing better you guys can do than move iron. I think
it's great.
The really
cool thing with weight training is that you can literally do it forever. And everyone possesses the ability to get stronger. And a lot of people that are in their 40s and even mid and sometimes even late 40s are some of the strongest people in the world. So Sojourner Savickas, multiple-time world strongest man champion, multiple-time Arnold strongman champion. He's going to be there again this year, and I think he's like 46. And he's, you know, he's one of the best. So age isn't really an excuse to not engage in fitness and not engage in strength.
Yep. Great answer.
Lastly, I got one other one that I saved just because Mark's been hitting the keto really hard lately. Keto, you touched on it a little bit, but do you think keto is the way to go for a fat guy? If you're overweight, is that really the only diet for you, or is there?
I think there's so many choices. Again, one of the things that attracts me to the diet is that, in my opinion, I'm going to put this in quotes, it's kind of a fat guy diet. A lot of men like bacon and cheese and eggs and steak. And I'm not saying that women don't, but a lot of guys are kind of into that kind of thing. So when you're allowed to eat those things, it can make being on a diet a little bit easier. But again, I do think there's definitely some problems with anytime you're going to have an extreme, and anytime you're going to engage in any sort of specific diet where there's a goal of like something mega of losing 20 pounds or 50 pounds or 100 pounds, I do think there needs to be an exit strategy towards something different. And so that's where I think
that's where it gets complicated.
Business or otherwise, I think you have to always have. I hear so many people say, I tried that diet, and then as soon as I stopped it, I gained weight. And you're like, well, that happens with any diet, because you're on a diet and you were paying attention to what you're eating, and now you're not paying attention to what you're eating, and you're not exercising anymore. Mm. So you lost control of everything. So the main thing is whatever you're going to engage in, don't have it be something that you're trying so hard with that it ends up leading to you being out of control at some other point.
Yeah, because the other thing, beyond the rebound, and I'm putting you in the spot, so I understand, you know, you're not doing the carbohydrates, but are you getting greens in?
Yes, absolutely.
Okay. And that's something that I think is why he's able to sustain.
You know, there's
right, but that's it's a non-starch carbohydrate. Yeah, yeah, right. I think a lot of times when you talk about the fat guy diet, they're like, oh, bacon, great,
right?
So great, eggs, great, steak, great, all these. Oh, but you've got to get the vegetables in because you're gonna overload your system with the animal cholesterols and fats, and I don't think you're gonna feel, or you're not gonna feel full enough,
right?
And therefore, you're gonna eat probably too much volume in the fat protein category, and then you're going to kind of have a mitigated loss because you've got too much on that end and not enough of the kind of the leafy greens and the, even if it's like roasted vegetables, whatever
it doesn't
is.
Matter what style of diet you're following, you have to adhere to good general principles of figuring out ways to eat less. I mean, it's just, there's no way around it, and vegetables
calories
are
calories still matter.
Yeah, they still matter.
As much as it sucks, calories still matter.
Vegetables are a great way for you to figure out to eat less because they are not calorie dense.
But I will tell you, it's so funny you say that. The one of the biggest problems I see, especially with obese people, is they don't eat enough.
Yeah, there's that.
Yeah. Well, you know, a calorie is simply a unit of measurement for energy. Right. Calories are good. Calories is fuel. Calories is what gets, you know, used
every
through your
fat
day.
Person eating this is like, my problem is I don't eat enough.
No, but often what happens is they stall out their system for hours through the day, and then they overeat at one time.
Yeah, right.
And your body's like, well, shit, man, I got a lot of fuel now. I'm gonna store some because
well, they
I don't
made
know
their metabolism super slow by engaging in many different things that caused their metabolism to slow down. Yeah.
So. I mean, you want to be sure to eat enough, but again, it's like when you see vegetarians and they're on the potato chip diet and they don't know where they're fat. I go, well,
you can eat vegetables. I've mentioned many times too, you know, like the ketogenic style diet. I've gotten in shape many different ways. I've done a bodybuilding style diet. I've used a ketogenic style diet. I've done a bunch of different things. I'm not trying to like promote it necessarily and talk about it as if I want everybody to do it. It's an option that's working well for me, and it's something that I do think that people should try if they're really struggling. It's something that you should put a little bit of effort into to see if it's something that you like, but it's not for everybody.
Well, do you want to say something?
I was going to say, just by the same token, people need to figure out, really, you figured out what works for you. People need to figure out what works for them.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
And it's you can't do it in a 6 or 8 or 12 week time frame. You have to keep working on it and keep tinkering with it.
I mean, I literally talk about it in my book, and that's why there are 5 programs in the book, but within there too is a section I call Body Talk. Listen to your body. It is smarter than you, okay? Mark understands what works for his body and his energy and what he's able to still, I mean, if he was doing this diet, but he didn't have the energy to lift and to move and have the power that he has and the output, he would think, I don't know if this feels right for me.
That's
and
a great
can, and
point.
And he would change those macros, okay?
Right.
I mean, down to rice and sweet potatoes are both great starch carbohydrates. And I remember I was doing rice at dinner a lot. I would make a kind of a vat at the beginning of the week and eat it. And then I just switched to sweet potato because I was like over it. And then the next morning I woke up like rested and I had abs and I just felt more energy and my gym session was better. And I was like, that was really weird. I think maybe I just slept well, whatever. And then I went back to rice and I realized that the rice, I don't digest as well. I don't have a gluten allergy. I don't have any problems. Mm-hmm. But my body did so much better on sweet potatoes than it did the rice. I tend to avoid rice now.
Right.
So just because I'm bloating, I wasn't sleeping as well. My output and my workouts weren't as good. I'm not crazy about it. I had rice today with you guys earlier.
Right.
But I do now favor different starches.
Make a
because
note.
My body let me know. And by the way, your body will let you know, guys, if you're bloated, if your energy's down, if you eat something and hours go by and you're not hungry, chances are your body's not breaking it down very well. So pay attention to you because there's no better judge of what should go in your body than you. And that's why this works for Mark so well because he's paid attention.
And some people, when they get to that point where they feel like it's not working out well, they just ditch the whole diet as opposed to trying to tinker with it and trying to...
Yeah, even in my book, I've got a spectrum of information going there. If I put quinoa there and it's like, quinoa's just not working on my body, put in rice. I mean, the principles are in place for a reason, but you've got to use your own brain to be accountable for how you feel because that's the daily choice that you have control over every day.
Right.
How have the people that you've worked with, I mean, I'd imagine these things get extremely emotional. You talked about people being eliminated from the show, you know, and when we watch the show, I've joked many times at seminars, you know, that I'll miss a lift and I'll be super pissed and I'll leave the gym and I'll on my drive home I'm crying, and then I sit there and eat a pint of Ben & Jerry's and watch Biggest Loser and continue just crying. I cry myself right to sleep.
But
there's a lot of emotion involved in the show. And there's just a lot that seemed a lot of energy that seems to go into trying to get these people to lose weight and stuff. How have some of these people, there must be a few that you've gotten really attached to, how have they affected your life?
Such a good question, Mark. You know, I think the saddest thing about Loser is that you guys can't see more of it. Mm-hmm. There are hours and hours of footage that doesn't fit into the 42 minutes of airtime that we get. And there's even hours and hours more that is not even on camera. The hours spent of just sharing my Sunday morning coffee with my team, and they make me breakfast, or we go on a hike, or late nights, you will have a huge day, a film day on a Saturday, and just to sit outside and back by the pool and sit and talk.
How long does this last, by the way? How many weeks is it?
Depending on the season length, 3.5 to 4.5 months.
Wow.
It's a stretch. I think the greatest thing that I learned, again, was as a fitness professional going in, I thought, I gotta have the answers, and I gotta have it together. And the moment I started to show the vulnerability in myself, it changed everything in our ability to communicate and their ability to trust me, and my ability to really learn about them further, and my ability, therefore, then to really help them. And in turn, they really helped bring out my purpose and my ability to be there for people. The letters they would write me week to week, the amount of times.
You must gain a lot of strength from that.
Oh my gosh. The way it's like I make a difference by being exactly me, and
that's cool.
It's such a microcosm because we've got them quarantined 24/7, right. And it's so real and it's so special because it's just real life. You know, we're able. There are things that no one will ever know that we talked about on the show, you know, because it was off cam and we had it. And it's the way that when I'm going home late after filming and I stay to train them again, and they're like, they're cooking me dinner now. You know, they're like, Jen, not so fast. We've got dinner for you. You know, and it's cool to see what I teach them to be put into action. Mm-hmm. And then also them teach me a lot. I mean, I'm a student as much as I am a teacher on that set. So it's really pretty cool because like the age range, I mean, there are people in their 50s and 60s.
Well, you must be learning what to say and what not to say because you're not in their shoes. I would imagine that you've never been on that side of the fence before.
No.
And so, you know, while, you know, in here, you know, this is a safe haven of us saying whatever the fuck we want to each other. And we tease each other all the time about being fat. But like certain things, you know, when you communicate with some of those people, the word fat might have such a negative thing that you have to be careful where that's dropped and things like that. You know, you got to probably be really cautious and you probably learn a lot.
But it's almost like usually people make jokes in fear of revealing how they really feel. Mm. Right. So the fat jokes are always going. It's when they start to talk about how much they hate themselves.
Mm. Right.
And they realize they hate the way they look. They hate this extra skin that's hanging. They're so upset at themselves that it goes so far. I mean, you don't realize the level of hate that they carry for themselves. And so when we get past the fat jokes, that's when the real conversation starts.
Right.
And the real unhappiness in their relationships.
I think that'd be a tagline for Super Training Gym.
Absolutely.
You know?
Yeah.
Well, on a practical level, these people haven't been working out for the most part when you start working with them. Like, how do you deal with soreness and recovery and mobility and all that stuff?
So you'd be actually surprised because of the amount of weight that they carry, there's actually quite a lot of muscle mass on them.
Oh, yeah.
Because they have to bear the load.
They do a lot on that show. I'm always shocked. I'm like, holy shit, man, they handle a lot.
I mean, as a trainer, you got to protect them, though. You got to protect the knees and the feet because my number one job as a trainer is to keep them healthy with forward progress. So I have to look at that. But a lot of what I do the first week is a lot of strongman training, a lot of concentric movement without eccentric. So like here without here.
Okay.
So I don't tear the muscle apart, but it's like push, 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 walk back, pull, 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 pull. So the soreness, I try to keep it low. Mm-hmm. I give them work to rest. I do a lot of on the minute training for them to say, hey guys, I need 5 push-ups, rest for 20 seconds. And they're like, 5. I got 5. I can do 5. And then it's a layered thing. But a lot of that too, is care. I mean, we've got physical trainers there. I've got ice baths. I go, let's go. Stay on top of it.
Do you have muscle stim?
Oh, yeah. We got it all.
Yeah. Shout out to Compex. We have our Compex sign out there. Compex has come back as a sponsor this year, and we thank them for being here because
we love them.
Yeah, really.
You know, with the amount of exercise that goes into them, starting to really make a lot of progress, start to lose a lot of weight. You see them start to do a lot of different exercises, but how do you get them started in the first place? Because some people are so unfit and some people have just real problems getting their body to move properly.
I like taking really seemingly scary movements and making them do them out of the gates, like a deadlift. I'm like, we're all deadlifting today. They're like,
right.
I'm like, all a deadlift is
just to break that,
picking something up and putting it down. Mm-hmm. We all do that with some of them, our parents, with their kids, with a grocery bag.
Just break the fear right away.
Totally. And then they go, I deadlifted today.
Yeah. And you could probably use the group to kind of drive it, right? Because you can pick someone that you know is going to do kind of well in it. And then you can have them set the tone for everybody else.
And that's it.
Somebody else sees them and they're like, I could do that.
Yep. Or even sit them on a rowing machine and we'll do power 10s. So like 10 strokes really slow, 10 just as hard and as fast, like powerful. You see the wattage, you're like, whoa!
Yeah.
Mark, you're only 130! Wow! You know, like, I fall off my platform. You know, just and they're just like, oh, you want them to feel pride in the movement. And so I set them up for success. I'm never going to pick something that someone can't do. Never, never, never. If I set them up where they can't do it, I have failed them.
Yeah.
100%.
I thought strongman is really interesting. Like doing the pulling.
I get the
pulling
of a sled. Walls. I'm like, I'll pick it up, talk it over. They're like, and like, it's so cute. Like these moms are like, what? Okay. Woo. And the drops. And they're like, oh, I go, yeah, now do it again. Like that's fun. I mean, and then.
Well, it gets to be empowering for them. And then they get to slam it next time they do,
oh,
right?
Oh my God. And then what's really fun is like, then we start to have like, my favorite times are off camera. And I bring like, I have my stereo system because we can't have any music on set because it's all copyrighted.
Right.
So then it's like the fight for who gets the music today. And there was one, I actually have a video of it. I'm gonna have to post it again so you guys can see it. But the Hernandez brothers, they wanted this Spanish, like Hispanic, Spanish station. I don't even know what it was. And they're playing music and they're starting to salsa and they're spinning me around. And I'm like, look at that confidence. You know what I mean? It was just cool because it starts to come through. And then the other girls fought for country one day. And then they're singing and they're starting to get after it. I mean, it just because it breeds other movement, you know, that's not just about working out. Because if it's just about the waistline, if it's just about work, I'm going to lose them.
Right.
It'll eventually not be worth it to them.
Yeah.
It's got to help a lot that they're around you for so many months and they're seeing that that you're like literally living the lifestyle, you know, like, oh, you know, coach
but
is
I also,
eating the
I'm
same
way.
But
I'm also honest with them. That's why I work out with them. I'm like, this was hard. One of my favorite things to do a couple months in, I mean, they love me, but by a certain point, they're like, Jen, again.
Yeah, fuck.
Yeah, so then I'll bring in like one of my buddies, Nick Wang. He came in, and Nick is like he's like Asian and Spaniard. Like he's this most handsome buff guy ever, and he came worked out, and the girls were like, "Thanks, Jen," you know. And he worked out, and the workout was hard for him, and everybody was like, "Whoa, that we did the same workout that he did." I was like, yeah. Or I'll bring him to like my local gym, like CrossFit Horsepower, and I'll make him pair up and I'll have my friends come or local coaches and they'll just jump in and they'll pair and to get to work, like to, you know, to be with someone that they're like, I can't keep up, to be partnered with and to feel a part of a group, not less than, not different, but partnered. I mean, that's the stuff that really gets special.
I forgot the fact that you're at Dan Wells' gym at CrossFit Horsepower. Yeah,
Horsepower.
Yeah, we had him on last year.
Oh, yeah.
Awesome dude.
Yeah, Dan.
Very cool.
Well, he should run for mayor.
before we drop off here, what's your, just parting message to somebody who's listening to this podcast and who just needs to get started? They just need to get moving.
I think the reality is that it's not so much about the access to start, it's the why you should. And I think a lot of times people are nervous to start because they thought of failure, what it's going to say, but ultimately you really got to look at the why of what you're doing it. And what I mean by that is if you make it about just weight loss or just transformation, it's not going to stick. What I can tell you, though, is if you make it about a bigger picture goal, it will make a bigger difference for you. So my why, and I'll leave you with this, okay? I know for me, if I am missing meals, I'm grabbing a random bar, you know, maybe I'm having like a sugary coffee drink, and I'm like, oh, I'm going to miss my workout. and now I string up a day of that and then 2 days of that. And because I'm not taking care of myself, I'm not worried about getting fat. I'm actually worried about the woman I start to become because I have more anxiety. I'm rude. I'm impatient. I am not as confident. I don't want to share in conversation. Dating someone, I get more insecure, more jealous. And you know what? I'm listing all these qualities and none of them are who I am. And none of them are who I want myself to be. And it is my responsibility to make choices in my day that make me feel good so I can be the woman that I am here to be. And that is my why. And I urge you guys to decide what kind of person you want to be in your day, because the decisions you make in the kitchen and in the gym, it's so much less about the waistline, which, by the way, you will drop weight because you do those two things. But it's so much more about the human you're going to be. And I urge you to make those good choices because that's in your hands and you can't blame anybody on that.
Just like I mentioned earlier, it's not what's in it for you. It's what you can become.
Totally.
Ba-boom.
Boom.
Where can people find you? Where can people reach you? Give us the name of your book.
Okay, so it's just Jen Widerstrom on all social media. J-E-N-W-I-D.
You just turn around.
Jen.
There we go.
There we go. And then book is Diet Right for Your Personality Type. Amazon's a great way to get it. Barnes & Noble, social media. I respond to everybody. What else do I need to tell you?
I think that's it.
Air hug. Thanks for listening.
Air hug.
You got to like send it though. You got to.
And next time I'll bring my Phoenix my American Gladiators action figure.
That would be awesome.
I kind of felt bad. I should have contributed today.
We need one of those really bad.
I know. It's the only one I have. I might donate it if you promise to take care of it.
She could be fighting with Jesus or Superman or saving Superman and Jesus or whatever.
Both. Both.
Yeah, all of the above. Special thanks to our sponsors, 8manstrongbodybuilding.com, Compex USA, Slingshot, of course, and the only strength magazine in the freaking world, The Power Magazine.
And your, where can people find you?
Multiply your hustle, multiply your muscle, and may all your shits be tapered. I'm at Mark Smelly Bell on Instagram and Twitter. Later.
I'm D. Jim McD on all the social medias where I'd want you to find me. Follow the show on Instagram. We are at Mark Bell's PowerCast, and we are Audi 5000.